Hey folks, welcome to another video on subquery, where we're going to take a closer look at GraphQL schemas. Jumping into the documentation here and navigating on the left-hand side to create a project, GraphQL schema, you'll see that the schema file essentially dictates the shape of your data from subquery. What this really means is that you create a schema file to define the type of data you want to extract from the blockchain. You can think of it as your interface definition language because it sits between your web application or your decentralized application or DApp and the blockchain. And if you're not familiar with GraphQL, I highly recommend you jumping into graphql.org/learn to get an introduction into GraphQL. But essentially, the file is created by defining what we call entities. You can think of entities as objects, and these objects contain fields such as name and address. And these fields have a type. So in this case, the name is a string and address is also a string. You'll see the supported scalars and types down below. And just a note that if you see an exclamation mark here, that this indicates that it's non-nullable. In other words, it's a mandatory or a compulsory field. You can also go ahead and add an @index keyword or annotation to improve the query performance. What this does is it adds an index on the entity field. So let's go ahead and jump into a subquery project to see how it works. Let's start off by creating the standard subquery project. So just running the standard subql init command and then the standard yarn install codegen and build, something that we should all be familiar with now. Now just before I run the codegen, let's open up the schema file first, and you'll notice that we've got the name of the object called starter entity. This could be anything really. Let's go my object, for instance. And in here, we've got the mandatory ID field. This is required. And then we have a range of fields called 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, the reason why we have five fields is if we go back into the documentation, you'll see that the current scalar types supported are ID, int, string, bigint, date and boolean. So all of these are demonstrated in the actual starter project. We'll cover the last two in a future video. So again, I can name these whatever I want, usually something more meaningful, like maybe block number. This could be, say, account. This may be value. For example, I'll call this account 2. This could be timestamp, really anything you want. This could be maybe success. Let's save this. Next up, we can run yarn codegen. And what this does is it generates code out of your GraphQL schema. So on the left-hand side under source, you'll see a new file appear. So let's run yarn codegen. And we've got a types folder. And under here, I've got something called myObject.TypeScript. If I open this, you can see this is auto-generated. So do not edit this. And you can see the various fields here that have been created and some automatic functions as well. Save, get and create record. Now, just a note, when you make changes to the schema file, you need to regenerate your type directory by running codegen. So that's saying that if you ever do change the shape of your data, you have to run codegen because this file needs to be updated. Now, remember I said that you can add an index? When you do, so for example, if I go at index here, let's save this. When I regenerate this, this is going to automatically create a function. So if I go back to my object file, you'll see that I'm going to get a new function appear here. So remember, I've got 53 lines. Let's go and run codegen. And then you can see here, I've got a new function called getByValue. And the reason why it's a value is because this is the name of my field, allowing you to access it directly in the mapping function as well. So that's what happens when you add the index annotation to a field. Many people often ask, how do I know how to define the shape of my data? So this is where you need to take a step back and do some planning and understand the data that you can extract and also the data that you want to display. Now, please note that this is a very simple example with one object type, because we can increase the complexity by adding more objects in here, and we can also have a relationship between these objects as well. One further way to understand schemas more is to jump into the Explorer project, and we'll take a look at some examples here. This is a great benefit of having an open source Explorer, where we can analyze some existing projects, such as maybe Subscan Multisig. Let's go and do Bitfrost maybe. And in this project, let's jump into the GitHub. And we'll dive right into the schema.graphql file. And here you can see we've got a block entity or object containing number, timestamp, parent hash, spec version. We'll ignore these ones down here because these are looking at relationships to other objects, and we'll explore these in a future video. We've got an extrinsic object down below, again containing a lot of the fields that you can actually extract from a Substrate blockchain. And scrolling down, we've got events, accounts, we've even got tokens and transfer as well. If I take a look at another one here, such as Bitfrost, let's open this one. Jumping into the schema GraphQL file. Again, we've got the default starter entity. Other objects are also defined, such as asset token, where we're pulling out symbol, precision, token supply, transaction by day, transactions. Also note that you can comment out using the pound symbol. And then we've got market price, day data, mint price, so lots of different objects in your schema file. So there we have it, a basic introduction into GraphQL schemas. Look out for a future video where we'll jump into entity relationships as well. Catch you next time.